hosting the Kubernetes, right? So today is a day one, right? Day one session, right? And we already learned Docker, right, previously, and a lot of things we covered in Docker, right? And the last part of the Docker which we learned was a Docker Swarm, right? So Docker Swarm is basically an orchestration system, actually. Okay, it's an orchestration system. See, what do you mean by orchestration, actually? Okay, let us open a new tab. Even Kubernetes. So we learned in the Docker session something on the Docker Swarm, right? What the Docker Swarm? You say the Docker Swarm is basically an orchestration system. It is basically an orchestration system. So in the Docker, if you want to achieve any in the Docker, if you want to achieve the orchestration, then you need to use the Swarm. So Swarm is something like a model, or it is a feature which is part of the Docker, actually. So we say it as a Docker Swarm. So it is basically an orchestration system. What is the meaning of orchestration, sir? Meaning? Anyone knows the meaning of orchestration? Sir, you know any meaning? What is the meaning of orchestration? Meaning? Anyone? No? See, basically, orchestration means actually it is like a hidden way of managing. It means that hidden way of managing means, suppose, for example, sir, when I will just take an example, sir. Like, for example, in India, right, we have 140 crore plus population is there, right? So many people are scattered across different states in India. And still, what is happening, that nicely a lot of management is happening, right? So that every person will get all kind of a basic accommodations in his life, right? He will get water, he'll get light, he'll get electricity, he will get gas, right? And why all these things, how all these things are happening? Because we have a system, actually. We have a law, we have a system, and the systems, like how the systems are generated, how the system came with the help of some policies or drafts, right? So where in Indian constitution we have set up a lot of drafts. Similarly, what is happening, the politician comes to the picture where they'll come up with a drafts or the bill. They will try to work on the bill so that the bill should be good for the people's welfare. Like that, right? A lot of politician comes and they draft a lot of bills and all. So with the help of these bills or draft, with the help of the political administration, right, all the things are going very smoothly in a very well manner. So some kind of a orchestration or some kind of a management is being happening at the back end. See, we don't know, right, how the water comes to our tap, right? But what happened at the back end, a lot of, like in Karnataka and Bangalore, we have a BWSSB, right? BWSSB, right? The water management system, right? Means Bangalore sewage and water management system, right? So they have a lot of plans to do that so that at the end, right, you are going to be able to get the water properly. So a lot of management is happening in the background, which we don't know, right? It's an all hidden management, right? Which we don't know how it happens, but things are happening very nicely so that we are able to comfortably get the water. Similarly, like for example, in a ground where there is a football tournament is happening, right? Outside the football stadium, there is one football coach is there, right? He will be sitting or he'll be standing and he'll be rewriting, hey, number 9, go there. Hey, number 10, come here. Hey, number 10, go to the goalpost, right? He'll keep redirecting the players, right? See, even though he understands the whole game plan or he understands the whole game activity, because he's the one who is teaching the game of football. But what happened, right? Being outside, he's actually instructing a lot of people to play the game properly so that you can achieve some goal, actually. Similarly, what is happening, that orchestration is nothing but it is management of the containers, actually. Orchestration is nothing but a management of many containers. You know very well, right, what is a container. We already discussed, right, whenever we want to run an application, basically application is a microservice based application, and you need to run an application, okay, in the container format, in the container. So basically what happened, right, you need to have an image for that application, right? So when you build an image and when you make the image to run, so how that application would get run, the application will get with will get executed or will be started running with the help of a container, right? That's what we learned in a Docker. So with the help of a container, you can able to run any of the applications, right? So whenever the container is getting created, we know that actually the container has a lot of resources in it, like, right? It has its own small minimal operating system. It has its own process management. It has its own memory. It has its own it has its own network management. So a lot of things are there within a container, right? So that everything your Docker engine provides, right? That's how we call it as a container. So if you have many number of containers which are running, right, how you can able to efficiently manage the execution of the container, right, with the help of some kind of orchestration tool. And that orchestration tool could be either Docker Swarm or either it could be Kubernetes, actually. That's all. Now, how you define a Kubernetes? Suppose somebody asks you, you have to say like this, sir, Kubernetes is a portable, extensible, like that you can say. See, I'm typing, everything is from the official documents. I'm not typing from my end. Kubernetes is a portable, extensible, and open source, open source platform, platform for managing containerized workloads and services. That's what we say, sir. So basically, Kubernetes is a portable, extendable, open source platform for managing containerized workload. It means that if you have a lot of containers, actually, if you have a lot of containers, to manage those containers, you need some kind of orchestration mechanism or the tool. So that is what the Kubernetes provides. Clear, sir? Now, this Kubernetes, it also facilitates both declarative configuration and automation, sir. So you'll understand this, all these things in a better way, when we are going further. What is this declarative configuration? What is this automation and all? We'll be learning. But you will see that actually this Kubernetes facilitates both, actually. It means that suppose you want to run in command line. Suppose I want to create some container command line. You have a commands to create a command line also. Same thing, actually. I want to do some kind of automation. I don't want to do in a command line. I want to do some automation. So basically what happened, you have to write some manifest file or YAML file. And then there is a process to write a manual YAML file. You need to follow some instruction and everything. And you need to automate certain things in the future. So your Kubernetes, it facilitates both, actually. It facilitates both declarative way as well as the automation way also. Okay. So that's what happened, right? Kubernetes is very famous because, like, you can achieve in both the ways. So obviously when you're working in a company, right, when you're working on Kubernetes, the more expectation from you is from the automation side, right? Because you need to automate many things. So you have to understand the process of how you can automate the things. So it means that you need to understand the complete Kubernetes to make many of the things as an automation part. So that's why Kubernetes facilitates both the things, actually. Okay. Now, so what are the things which Kubernetes provides? So these are some theory stuff, sir, which we'll be discussing. So I'll be writing it down. See, we can even say Kubernetes, or in short, we can even say K8S, actually. So K8 is not, but it's a Kubernetes, actually. Okay. What are the things which Kubernetes provides us? So it provides the service discovery and load balancing. Okay, load balancing. It provides the storage orchestration. It provides you might have seen this in the Docker, we saw automated rollouts and rollbacks. Rollback we saw, right, in Kubernetes, Docker, right? So even Kubernetes also provides that features, actually. And we have something like automatic bin packing. What is this? We'll see later, sir. Automatic bin packing. This is a very interesting thing. We have to learn about. These are all the things which Kubernetes provides to us. It has a feature of self-healing. Kubernetes has a feature of self-healing. It has something like, secrets. and secrets and configuration management. Correct, manage management. Right, that's all. I mean, these are all some of the features actually. So that's what Kubernetes provides, so many features to us. That's what it makes very much different from that Docker actually. Okay, there are many differences are there. That's what, but these are some of the features which makes it very, very different from the Docker. That's what, instead of going with the Docker Swarm as an orchestration mechanism or orchestration system, people will prefer to go with the Kubernetes actually. But practically, I will tell you all those things, how exactly the practically differs from Docker Swarm to Docker Kubernetes, I will tell you, then you'll be able to understand in a better way. Okay, we will see now how Kubernetes comes to the picture. We have to see the history of the Kubernetes also. So that also is a very important that we have to learn it actually. So we know that actually Kubernetes is a, Kubernetes is a open source container orchestration system or orchestration tool or system, you can say, anything you can say. Right, sir. Now, see if you, how exact, if to understand the Kubernetes, sir, we have to get into some, we have to get into some basic understanding about why we need an orchestration actually, firstly. What is the use of orchestration? See, if you see, right, if you go back to the very old days, right, where suppose, for example, assume that we have some application, something like a Netflix, sir, actually. Okay. We have some application known as Netflix, actually. You say that, Rajesh, I want to deploy my, my streaming, my media streaming, application known as Netflix, actually. Now, what happened if you go with a very long back, right? What happened, right? Suppose a very long back, I was having one server. I used to procure on server. In that server, what is happening that I used to install an operating system, you know very well, right? I used to install an operating system, install all kind of a libraries related to it, libraries and softwares, right? Basically used to create some software stack, right? And this server, basically, it has some configuration, sir. Like, for example, the server might have a configuration of something like it is 32 GB RAM, right? 4 core CPUs, right? And some 500 DB of hard disk, HDD drive, hard disk, right? This is the, what your server configuration, right? On this server configuration, what you used to do is to install an operating system, you used to install a library and blah, blah, blah. And finally, what is happening that you used to install or you need to, what is to do, you used to run or used to make your Netflix application run here in your operating system, in this machine, Netflix. So, okay, fine. All these days, your application is running fine. And also what is happening that with your machine, what happened, right? You used to provide an IP address also, right? Suppose something like 10.172.17.5. Some IP address is also there, okay, because what happened, that, but ultimately, right, whenever the client want to access your application, right, he has to hit some IP address, right? He has to hit up an IP address, or else what happened, right, he cannot, the client or the customer cannot give the IP address like this, right? Whenever you want to access the application, he cannot do, right? What he has to do? He has to basically, here, he has to do www.netflix.com, right? Like that, he used to type the domain name, right? So basically, what is happening, that what he used to do, right? You used to have a DNS server, right? So what you will do, you will have a DNS server. A DNS server is there. In that DNS server, you will make an entry here. What is the entry? Whoever is hitting 10.172.17.5, right? Then it has to, right? Then what happened? It has to go through the netflix.com like that. So you made an entry in the DNS server. It means that whoever the customer is hitting the netflix.com, what happened, right? The control will come to your DNS server, right? From the DNS server, actually what happened, right? If you are maintaining some kind of a load balancer, it goes to a load balancer here, right? The load balancer here. And from the load balancer, actually what is happening, that the traffic used to go and it used to access this application here. So this is a kind of a load balancer here. So there are many things come to the picture, right? When we are discussing hosting any application, that you should have a DNS, you should have a load balancer, because it's not only one machine. So there could be several machines. Now what is happening, that assume that lot of, it's not only one or two customers, hundred thousands of customers are hitting this application. And this application is, it's just running in only a single standalone machine. Now what is happening, that there will be a bottleneck for your application. Your application might come down, because there is a lot of load or traffic is there, because a lot of people are accessing the same application. Now what happened, right? Now this was a traditional, right? Now what happened, right? You think that, okay, man, let me deploy one more server actually. Let me have one more server. That means that you need to procure a new server in the market. The same configuration, or maybe more than, or the same higher configuration, you used to buy a server. And then what happened, that same stuff you used to do is to install the OS. And finally, what is happening, that you used to install all libraries and packages and everything. And here also you used to host the Netflix.com application. And you have an IP address. The IP address you used to, the IP address, whatever the IP address you get right here. Like for example, here you have one, here what happened, one more IP address you have to give, right? 10.172.17.6. So what is to do? You used to add this IP address entry in your load balancer, right? So what happened, right? Now what happened, you are able to better manage the traffic. It means that if there are more loads are coming, what is happening? There are two servers are there which can serve the service for the customer. So, but the bottleneck here is actually that you have to procure a lot of hardware. So it's a lot of, a lot of investment is required actually. That is one thing, right? But the point here is that actually that this is, on-premises. Now what happened, right? As the cloud came into the picture, you know that the cloud came into the picture. Now here, the one thing is here is that actually, see here, when you are hosting any application, you need to take care of many of the things. You need to take care of the load balancer. You need to take care of the DNS server. You need to even manage the IP addresses, right? You need to even check that the Netflix, whatever it is running, it gets enough memory so that it is running up and running. So a lot of things as a user, like I'm a user or I'm a system administrator, I have to take care of everything, right? It means that Rajesh, who's an administrator, he has to orchestration many things. I have to orchestration. There's no automation for that. Oh, I have to check whether load balance is working or not properly. Oh, DNS is up and running. The OS is up and running. I need to manage a lot of things actually. And also, like, because it's not one or two machines, there's hundreds of machines where the Netflix application is running. So I need to really maintain a lot of things actually. So it means that an administration has to maintain a lot of stuff. He has to completely orchestrate the whole system so that this application should not go down, right? So there's a pain for the administrator or the person who is managing the whole thing actually. Now what happened, right? If we shift from here to one step, so this was a legacy. From here, he shifted to, see, these things we already discussed in a Docker, sir. To some extent, we discussed it. I'm just telling you, I'm reiterating some of the things, same thing, but I'll come into the picture, like why exactly Kubernetes is more helpful when it comes to orchestration. I'll be just discussing those things in the upcoming now. Okay. Now what happened, right? Now we shifted to something, we shifted to the cloud, actually. Shift to the cloud. Now, you know very well, like a lot of clouds providers are in the market. Like we have AWS or Azure or GCP, right? Or else you have a digital platform, you have a digital ocean, or else you have a Rackspace, you have a IBM cloud, or you have a Oracle cloud. Like a lot of cloud providers are there actually. Same. Now what is happening? You said that, Rajesh, the same application now I want to host in my cloud environment. Same thing. What you will do? Here also, what you will do, you need to have in the cloud also, you will be having a system where what is happening, that you will be procuring a lot of VMs. You need to provide a lot of VMs, virtual machines you have to provide. Like in AWS, we create any VMs with the help of an EC2 service, right? We know that very well, EC2 service. We have an EC2 service. Through the EC2 service, we can actually create any VMs. So here in the VM also, what is happening, that you need not to install any operating system, because all the VMs or EC2 comes with some operating system. Either you can select Ubuntu or CentOS or any other operating system. So that headache is not here. And also the libraries and with the dependency package, everything will be there. You need not to worry. So now what happens, that you need to only worry about just hosting your application, Netflix. Similarly, what, and here also, you, here what happened, manually used to create an IP address or assign an IP address and all. Here in cloud, that management of the networking it doesn't really require that much. It means that actually that suppose like to, tomorrow you need to, you have to create multiple EC2. You know that actually to get the network connectivity, you need to have a VPC, right? You have to create a VPC. It means you have to enable the VPC. VPC should be there. You have to use a VPC to make sure that whatever the application which has been hosted in different VMs, you will have a connectivity. It means that you will be able to communicate from one machine to other machine with the help of a VPC. That you need to take care actually. As well as what is happening that if any machine goes down or if any machines get drained, actually, you need a, you need some kind of an auto scaling also. And this also the feature of your is of your cloud itself. Auto scaling also the feature. Since apart from the application, application hosting in the VM, there are many other things other which you need to set up in your cloud also to manage certain things, right? So let it be this one. Also, you should also enable the load balancing also, right? We know very well in your cloud, right? You need to even enable the load balancer. You need to procure a load balancer. You need to use a load balancer here also. Of course, here also we have load balancer, external load balancer. Here, what happened in AWS, it provides an internal load balancer actually. So we'll be using. So what I'm trying to tell you is that the same thing here also, sir, whatever the on-premises we're using to host an application, the same thing here also, we're managing the same thing. But here what happened, instead of here, this could be a physical machine or this could be a virtual machine, whatever. And here what is happening, we are actually accessing everything in the cloud through the VMs itself, actually. So through the EC2 service, or the VMs are getting created. And to manage the VMs and all, you need to provide the cluster, you need to enable the auto-scaling, VPC, load balancer. Many other things has to be managed to make sure that your application is always available. Now, what happened, right? You just migrated from one generation to other generation, but here what happened in the cloud, we have come into the picture, fine. But the point here is that, again, you need some kind of a person who has to manage the whole setup. Means he has to make sure that this VM should, the health of the VM should always be up and running. The application should not go down. For that, what is happening, he has implemented auto-scaling also. Through auto-scaling, if this machine goes down, automatically what happened, right? The auto-scaling is going to enable in one more new VM, and he'll make sure that this application will be up and running in that newly created VM. Similarly, the load balance has to be maintained. So because whatever the IP addresses we have with the different VMs, right? That you need to set up in the load balancer. And of course, the load balancer will be set up with the DNS server. You need to have a DNS entry, everything. So it's the same kind of a stuff here, actually. Now, what is happening is that actually here also, you need to orchestrate many things as an admin. So it means that there was a pain in orchestrating all these resources. Now, what is happening is that after these things, now you know that there is something known as a microservices came into the market, right? Like it means that actually you need to cut off all the applications into a smaller microservices, and a technology known as a container came into the picture. We started running all our application in the container, right? So what we did actually, so same system, what is happening that now the story has changed now. Now what happened that you need not to have, I mean, you should have a VM, but what is happening is that you would be in the same cloud. Assume that I'm just allocating a very big server, a large server, right? It could be some big, large server you might be using in the cloud actually. Here, what is happening that the same Netflix application, you'll be running in some containers actually, many more containers, right? Even for this containers also, sir, to make the containers up and running, you need a lot of other resources also. Here also, you need some kind of a load balancers. Like for example, you have something like the Ingress load balancer. You remember, right? I had explained about this in our Docker, right? But anyhow, we will be full-fledged, we'll be learning this Ingress load balancer in Kubernetes. Actually, we need a load balancer here also. We need a lot of resources to manage these containers and everything. So what has happened means, when it comes to the container management, it is very easy to manage a container. It means that suppose tomorrow, if this container is up and running, if this container get killed or it get drained actually, no problem. In a very easy way or in a very faster way, you can actually make one more container up and running. So managing of the container means whatever the application we're running, right? Netflix, you might be running this Netflix inside this containers actually. If one of the net contents go down, no problem. You have a system you have an orchestration system where you can build up or you can make up the container to come in a very faster, within a fraction of a second, you will make your container up and running. So here, manageability of everything through the container concept become very easy. It means that earlier the application was either hosted in the physical machine or in the virtual machine. Slowly the technology progressed and we came with a microservice and we build all, we are running all those microservices or the application through the container technology. And to managing, it becomes very easy, right? Now that's the reason what is happening, that we came up with a lot of orchestration tool, and one among was the Docker Swarm. To the Docker Swarm, we are able to manage in a better way. And after that, we came with the Kubernetes actually. So that's what, why we have to learn the Kubernetes, right? Kubernetes provide the best. It means that, see, whatever the resource is required for this content up and running, Kubernetes at the back end will provide everything. It also checks the health of the application, whether the application is up and running in that pod actually, in the pod running, okay? And how many containers are running, what are the desired state it is running. There are a lot of stuffs are there which Kubernetes manages in a very easy way. And in a backend it manages, or it in a hidden way it manages, so that a user like me, an end user, like whoever is, suppose like he's sitting outside. So a person is sitting outside, right? He need not to worry about this actually, because he knows that if you have a Kubernetes actually, Kubernetes can manage everything easily. So what happened at an end user, he'll always interact with the Kubernetes, and the Kubernetes will make sure that he manages the entire container running that application in a desired state, in a healthy state. So that's what we have to learn the Kubernetes, sir. Clear, sir? I hope you got something, whatever I'm trying to tell you. So now that's how, sir, that's how it is a better way of managing the whole resources, right? The container resources in an efficient manner. It can be done through the Kubernetes very well. Now, if you see, right, if you see the difference of the Kubernetes and Docker, actually, you have a Docker, sir. Suppose you have a Docker, sorry. You have a Docker system, sir. You have a Docker system. In the Docker, actually, so we have a Docker and we have a Kubernetes, sir, actually. I'm just taking, here in the Docker, we have a lot of containers. A lot of containers are running, sir. Right, you know, in the Docker, we have to always set any one machine as a master. You're right, you know, right? It was set as a master, and all other nodes are a working node. Like this one would be worker node, actually. Worker node one, like this. Worker node two. And worker node 3. Right. So now what happened, right? Here, what happened in, you used to select any one as a master node and one as a master node. And what happened, right? You will make this as a master node. And what you used to do, you used to always run a command whenever I want to set up the, what is to do? You used to do something like the Docker Swarm init. You remember, right? You are initializing it actually. So Docker Swarm init. So when you execute the Docker Swarm init, what happened at this system or this node will be act like a master actually. And some kind of a components is to get installed in this master. What are those components if you see it actually? The components were something like a API server, controller, and scheduler actually. So these are the some of the components which will get installed in a master node when you're executing the Docker Swarm init to make it as a master node. And where all these components were to get installed, this component is to get installed in the OS, in the operating system. Right? Now, after that, what happened, right? Your master, after you execute, it is to provide a line saying that any worker node are there. If it want to join into the master cluster, right? He has to execute some command actually. So the joining method also the master provides after all these components are getting installed. So that if the worker node try to, you know, like execute those command, those worker nodes would able to join the master node. Similarly, here also, if you run that command, it is to join the master node. So basically, you used to create some kind of a clustered environment so that, you know, you will be able to host any of the application in this clustered environment, right? The same thing here also in Kubernetes also, sir. In Kubernetes also, you have many of the machines or the nodes actually, many of the servers. Here also what happened, right? We call it as a master node, or you can call it as a control plane. We can either call it a master or we can call it as a control plane. Anyway, both are same actually. Control plane. And here you have a nodes actually. Same thing. Node 1, node 2, node 3, like that actually. Now what is happening is that now in the Kubernetes also, whenever you want to make a particular machine or the particular server as a master server, the control plane, you need to initialize or you need to run a command known as a kubeadm init like this. Now what is happening is that when you execute the kubeadm init, some kind of initialization will happen and the component of the master like API server, controller and scheduler, this used to get run as a container. Please understand, sir, all this API server, controller, and scheduler, they used to run. Even like I want to add one more thing, sir. Sorry, I missed it actually. One more component is database actually. Okay, database. Here also, after initializing the Docker swarm, even there is to have a database, internal database. Similarly, even here in Kubernetes, we used to have a database, and the database name, what we call here in Kubernetes, is etcd, sir. This is the database name which we used to call. So here also what happened, right? Now, when you are initializing the Kubernetes, all these components like API server, controller, scheduler, database, etc., they used to run as a container. Here what happened? Same, all these components here in the Docker, it has to directly get installed in the operating system. But here it is running as a container. It is not directly installing in operating system, all these components, but it is running as a container. So what is the advantage of being running as a container? You know very well that if there's an API server which is up and running, so with the help of a replica or if with the help of auto scaling, you could have many more containers of the same application API server component, right? If any one of the containers goes down, or suppose if API server itself will go down, it means that what the orchestration or the auto scaling will do, that automatically what happened, one more container will get created. It means that actually within a fraction of a second you will get created. So like that, what happened, any one of the component goes down, like controller goes down, or scheduler goes down, or database goes down, no problem, you will recreate one more new container. That is the concept of container, right? Whenever any container get killed, right, one more new container will get created, right? We saw in the Docker, right? Similarly here also in Kubernetes, any one container will get killed, automatically a new container will get created. So what is happening, that here what happened, you need not to worry about it. It means that because all these Kubernetes master components, right, they'll be running as a container, whereas the same component in Docker will be installed in the operating system. Means, suppose assume that the API server, which is running, which is part of the operating system in the Docker, right? If this service goes down, it means that the whole master will go down, actually. Similarly, what happened, right? Here, suppose scheduler goes down. In the operating system itself, the scheduler will not properly work. It means that the whole master will not work. It means that your whole Docker swarm will come down. It will not able to work. Unless and until you have one more master node. Suppose that it's not only one master node, you have maintained one more master node. In that case, what happens? The other master node will take a service. But assume that actually in only one machine, you are having a master node. And in the operating system, all these components are installed. If the operating system will go down, or if any one of the server is not responding properly, that goes down, it means the whole Docker swarm will go down. The whole Docker orchestration system will go down. This is a disadvantage in Docker. Whereas an advantage in Kubernetes is that actually all these services will be running as a containers actually. To managing the container is very simple, is very easy. So you will not see any kind of a downtime for any kind of the service which is running in your master node. This is one difference, sir, the key difference. If suppose somebody asks you what is the difference between Docker and Kubernetes, you have to say the same thing. Like, what you have to say that? You have to say that, sir, all these components to make it as a Docker master, like API server, controller, scheduler, database, etc., many more are there. I'm just listed some of the. This will get installed as a part of an operating system or inside the operating system. Hence, what is happening, that you need to depend upon this all the services to be up and running as a part of an operating system. If any one service goes down, automatically the whole Docker swarm will come down. You'll not be able to do it unless and until you have one more backup of the master, unless and until till that time. Whereas in Kubernetes, all the services will not be installed as a part of an operating system, but rather they will be running as a container. And we know that managing container is very simple. It means that if any one node goes down, if any one container goes down, it will recreate the same container again. That is one thing. And the second difference is actually because Docker is actually what is happening. So Docker is actually built by the Docker community. There's a Docker community or there's a Docker, Docker community. What has happened, right? The source code of this Docker community, they have not made it as an open source. They have kept it as it. They kept within them. It means that you cannot, suppose you said, Rajesh, whatever these components are which are getting installed as a part of an operating system in Docker, suppose tomorrow some developer says that I want to customize this, some of the things according to my requirement. You cannot do customization even when it comes to Docker Swarm, because the Docker community, they will try to make sure that all these components get by default get installed while installing in the operating system itself. So customization is not possible in this case. Whereas here, because Kubernetes is an open source, it's an open source orchestration. That's what I say. It's an open source. So, and all these components of this Kubernetes will be running as a part of the container. Suppose tomorrow some developer say that whatever API server is there, I want to do some customization according to my requirement. Yes, it's an open source. You have a code. You can go and change it, edit it, and do or whatever you want. And later you can make it to create as a container here in this master. Similarly, all these components. Hence, what is happening that changes can be done onto the component of this master, Kubernetes master, because it is an open source. So this is a second difference. That's what in many of the companies, you could see that a lot of companies are actually running their Kubernetes in their own customized fashion. It means that they have customized. So one of the example, if you want it, right, you have a Red Hat companies, Red Hat company, there is a Kubernetes which they provide as an OpenShift actually. So what they did, right, OpenShift, right, they took the Docker, they took the Kubernetes, they customized according to it, and they came up with their own product, which they call as an OpenShift actually. And OpenShift in Red Hat is something like, it's a PaaS service, platform as service actually. And we know that the market, a lot of market value is there for the OpenShift. And because whatever the Kubernetes is there, right, on top of it, what happened, Red Hat has developed a library or an interface. Through that interface only, okay, you can communicate with the Kubernetes. So they have did a lot of customization with all these components of the Kubernetes. And finally, they came up with their own product, known as the OpenShift product. And it is a PaaS product, platform as service product, right? And this is very famous. You know, like some of the companies are using OpenShift like anything for managing the, orchestration, like to achieve an orchestration, they are using OpenShift. So this we will be discussing later. So you understood the difference between the Docker and Kubernetes, right? That's what happened, right? A lot of people want to switch to the Kubernetes because whatever the manageability is very easy, and also like all the things are running as a container itself. To manage it as a container, it is very simple. Whereas the Docker has some disadvantages. That's what Kubernetes is more famous. Of course, there are many more features are there which you are not seeing in a Docker, but you will find it in Kubernetes. Because of that also, Kubernetes is very famous. Okay, sir. So till here you are clear, sir, whatever I said, or you have any doubts?
Yeah, sir. Good, sir.
What about others, sir? Okay. So that's all, sir. Now what is happening now, sir? Now, what we have to do means we have to set up a Kubernetes actually, or installing the Kubernetes. Now, there are many ways are there, sir, to set up a Kubernetes and all. Like what you can do, you can take some three VMs, means you can install the VMware. On top of the VMware, you can create three images. Any of the images, like suppose like you create some CentOS, 7 or CentOS, three image or three VMs you create actually. Okay. In the three VMs actually, you can install you can set up the Kubernetes actually. But again, it depends like whether we have this VMware installed in our system and all. And the second is that actually, you can actually choose any cloud actually. Choose any cloud. Right, preferably AWS or Azure or Google Cloud, anything. Right. Here what happened, right? You can actually choose from three nodes or three servers, three VMs, and do an install of Kubernetes in these three machines. So for us, this would be the easier part, right? Right, because like we will not be having a VMware where I'll have a three images of CentOS or Ubuntu and then setuping and everything. So that is not, might not be feasible now actually. But whereas yes, we have a cloud account and everyone has a cloud account and we would be running under the free tier now. Still, we would be having a free tier. So we can take up some three VMs, EC2 machines, right? And we can install Kubernetes and we can play it everything. So this would be feasible for us. So for our whole journey of Kubernetes, right? I'll be explaining everything in Azure itself. AWS itself actually. But of course, what I'll be doing, when it comes to installation part of Kubernetes, I'll be even explaining or showcasing how to install the Kubernetes in Azure, how to install the Kubernetes in GCP, like that. So this is what we are manually installing the Kubernetes, sir. It means that either you can install in VMware or either we can install through the cloud way. And the third is actually like, many of the cloud, they are providing the services actually. They're providing the service. Like for example, AWS, the most famous is GCP, so Google Clouds actually. There is a service on GKE, which is called as a Google Kubernetes Engine actually. This is the service, or this is what it is provided by the GCP. It means that you need not to go and install and manage and everything. That is not required here because you can use the service which is provided by Google itself, which you call the GKE. Similarly, for the Azure, you have a AKS. We call it an AKS, Azure Kubernetes Service actually. Services. Similarly, for the AWS, we have EKS, Elastic Kubernetes Service. So these are all the cloud. These are all the services we provide the cloud itself. That means that. So tomorrow you said, Rajesh, I don't want to manage the whole stuff, man. Why you have to go and create some nodes and all, install the Kubernetes, manage and run many of the steps and all? I don't want to do. I don't want to do an administrative aspect of it, man. I want to use a director. Like I use this Google Cloud GKE. As soon as a director I use. So what it'll give, it'll provide me some information I have to give, like how many VMs you need. Oh, I need three VMs. Out of three VMs, one VM, one machine, I have to call it as a master node. Other two have to make it as a node. Only some few information you have to provide for this GKE, sir. Automatically, what happened, right? It'll create a Kubernetes environment for you. And you need not to manage anything, actually. Directly, whatever your application is there, you can directly host that application in the GKE. So that's what it has become very simple in cloud actually, because like they are giving as a service. But many companies till today also, you could see that actually they have set up the whole Kubernetes environment on the on-premises, not even in the cloud, on the on-premises, and they're managing it very well. And some companies, you know that actually they have shifted to the cloud and they said, okay, this service might become too costly for me. I don't want to do that. But yes, in the cloud, I can create some virtual machines and I can set up my own customized Kubernetes and set up everything. And I can host my application in my customized Kubernetes environment in the cloud itself. In this case, what happened that you need to manage it, everything. It means that you need to even procure the VMs and all. You need to install it. There, the installation, configuration, setup, everything the user has to do, right? But whereas the cloud itself, they are providing the services here, it has become still more easy. You need not to do anything. You have to only give some basic information to the GKE or AKS. It automatically will set up and give to you, and you can host your application directly over there. So here what is happening that many of the companies have chosen to go in this way also. And so it depends. Wherever you go, right? Tomorrow, if you go for a Kubernetes job, right? You cannot expect that, okay, they are using the Kubernetes in the in the cloud itself like this as a service. No, it could not be there. They could be using on-premises, or they could be even using in the cloud with the VM setup and everything. And it could be in any way. So, or else in some companies, you know that now the companies are even using the OpenShift, as you discussed. Oh, they're using OpenShift. OpenShift is still more easy way of managing the orchestration method. That's what a lot of companies are preferable to choose, as well as many other, like clouds are there, like a DigitalOcean. They are also providing their own, Kubernetes service like that. So like that, you will see that many of the companies have opted their own way of managing the orchestration through the Kubernetes. So if you have a knowledge, you can work in any environment. So it doesn't really matter for you. Clear, sir? So that's what I would say. Okay. Now, okay. So, okay, sir, a few more things, sir. Then we will stop the session, because I don't think so today we'll be able to cover the installation part. Maybe the next week we will be covering the installation part. But before going into anything, before getting installation or understanding it, let us understand the history of Kubernetes, sir. This is very important, sir, to understand even the history of Kubernetes. Now, in the way back 2003, sir, okay, Google, it had its own internal project, which they called as Omega and Borg, sir. Now, what happened, right? The Google developers, they developed two projects, which they called as Omega and Borg. And with the help of this Omega and Borg, actually, they used to run their applications by using a lightweight container method. So with the help of a Borg, actually, this is the main project, and through which they used to create a container, and they used to run their, Google used to run their own application with the help of the container, and that container, they used to get the container with the help of a Borg, actually. So this was a project. It means that very, very long back, what happened in 2003, they developed this, and many of the applications, Google's internal applications, they were already running in their own container method or in their own containers, actually. How the container they used to get created with the help of a Borg, actually. Okay, this was running from very long time. So from very long time, they used to use this container technology. Then later, after some point of time, what Google thought, that let us give this Borg and Omega, or let us share this container concept, everything, to the outside world, so that other people will get benefited. So that's what the company did, right? In 2014, Google gave this Omega project, Omega as well as Borg, to a company known as the Linux Foundations. Basically, Linux Foundation is an open source org, actually, and where they're working on a lot of projects based on the open source, actually. Okay, so they donated this project, Omega and Borg, to the Linux Foundations, actually, Linux Foundation. And in the Linux Foundation, there are a lot of other sub-foundations are there, but one of the sub-foundation within the Linux Foundation is but CNCF, actually. What is that? Cloud, very important, sir. Cloud Native Computing Foundation, sir. There are many organizations are there, sub-organizations, but one of the key organizations within the Linux Foundation is Cloud Native Computing Foundation. Now, what happened, right? And the Google, this Omega and Borg project, to the Linux Foundation, said that, okay, we have come up with some kind of a technology, as a container technology. Even you can make use of this project to create a container, run your application under the container, like that. They gave the whole source code, everything, to the Linux Foundation. What Linux Foundation did, under it, there is a Cloud Native Foundation. It gave these two projects to this Cloud Native Computing Foundation. And they said that, you please work more on this, and to make sure that you bring out some kind of a product out of this project, actually. But what is the condition, what the Google had kept that? Google kept that, the condition that you should not use this as a name while coming up with your own product. You should give some other name. But internally, this project is still alive in the Google, and still we are using this project. It means that the name of the project Borch, the Google is using the same product name actually, project name Borch and Omega. So Google told not to use the same name. That's what, that is the one condition that kept. Anyhow, Cloud Native Foundation, what happened there? They took the code and they did a lot of development activity. They made it as a front end GUI, this one, and they made a lot of changes in the code, and they understood it, communicated with everyone with a good to understand still more better way. And finally, what happened, right? The Google, the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, they released the first version of container orchestration tool, which they called as a Kubernetes. Kubernetes, and they released in 2015, so just after 1 year actually. And the first version which they released was version 1.0. That's the first version which they released it actually. Okay, and what is happening is that, see, if you go through a Google, see here, if you go through a Google search, you just say Omega, Borg, and Kubernetes. See. You'll get many articles are actually like this. You'll get many articles on Omega and Borg. They have written it, and you'll even get get a lot of information about it, right? And here what is happening is that if you see it actually, Cloud Native Computing Foundation. So this is one of the sub-organization of your Linux foundations, right? So you have this is the official site, sir. And a lot of projects have been built here, actually. Okay. If you come down, actually, you would see that there are many other projects. See, Helm is also one of the projects are like that. And if you want to really see, if you come to the contribute here, and if you, I want to become a contributor, see, you could see that under the CNFF, there are so many projects are running, sir. Kubernetes project, Prometheus, container ID. This is like something like a Docker we have, right? So this is the container ID, which is own a container mechanism, which has been created by the CNCF, Cloud Native Computing Foundation. Like that, you have many of the projects which are running. So you could see that many of the other projects are running over here also. So there are a lot of projects, sir, which are running, Sandrock projects are running under the CNCF actually. And Prometheus and Grafana, Prometheus, Grafana, Kubernetes, Helm, these are all the major projects which are running under the CNCF actually. Okay, so and CNCF, this Kubernetes is basically, it is designed with the help of a Go language. You know, Go language also developed by the Google itself. The same Go language also used in developing Docker. The same Go language is also developed for developing the Prometheus also. Okay, so that's what it is. And after what happened, right, the Kubernetes, they released the version V1.0. And today you could see that we are having a version. The very highest stable version was 1.18 version. Now today we have V1.22. And in December, if I'm not wrong, on 26th something, they are releasing 1.23 version. So, but most of the people, they'll be working on 1.18 because it's a very highly stable version, Kubernetes stable version. That's all. But we know that in every, in every 6 months, right, they'll be keep releasing a new product actually. Like today we have V1.2.123, 124. So, and you could see that somewhere you could even see like this V1.22.1, V1.22.2. Like that, you will see this version. Now you could see that, Rajesh, it's some, what is this V1.22.22? What is this 1.22? So one is something like, it's a major release. This 22 is something like a minor version or major version or minor version. And this 1, 2, 3, whatever you're seeing, right? This is nothing but it's a patch releases actually. This is what the nomenclatures are actually. This is how they call it as a, how you have to define this 1.20.2. It means that the major release, first is a major release actually, minor release actually. You could see that V1.18, 1.19, 1.20, 21, 22, 23. These are minor release. After releasing, suppose assume that in the December, as I said, they are releasing 1.23. But what happened in another few weeks, actually, right? 1 or 2 weeks, they want to release some patch, actually. What they will do, they'll release a patch, and finally that version will be called as a V1.23.1. And tomorrow, there is one more developer is there who he wants to release a patch now. Now he'll release one more patch. Now the next patch will be called as a 2.2. Like that, the patch will be, whenever you are increasing the patch, right? This patch release version, the last digit will be keep incrementing, sir. That states that it is a patch release. Okay, sir. So that's how, sir. That's how the history of your Kubernetes actually. Okay. So Google did it. They gave this source code, everything to the Linux Foundation. And that's how the journey started with the Kubernetes. And today we could see that it's a completely open source. We can even walk through the whole source code of the Kubernetes. We can understand internally how exactly things are working in Kubernetes, sir. That's all. So we just started today, sir. Very, very basic things. We have not yet covered that much, actually. But what I would say that we need to understand the architecture. What would be the next session, actually, the day two? The day two will be, you need to understand the Kubernetes architecture. Kubernetes architecture, that's what we have to learn, understand. Means what are the different components of the Kubernetes are there? That we have to understand. That is very, very important when it comes to the intro point of view also. You have to understand each and every component very well, because they'll be asking heavily all those things itself. And we have to understand the different installation methods. We have not yet covered those things. Very interesting, sir. We need to learn about this also, different installations also. And also we need to understand about the Kubernetes commands, actually. So these are some of the things which we'll be covering in our day two, sir, in the next week. Very interesting, sir. And we'll be learning a lot from here. From here, the journey starts, sir. From your Kubernetes architecture, installation methods, that's how it starts, actually. And a lot of things, other things will come into the play. Okay, sir. So, okay, sir, are you okay till here?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. Today we just started, sir. Yes, sir. You know, we need not to worry that much, but moving forward from next week onwards, we'll be completely getting into a lot of theoretical understanding as well as practically. Parallelly, we'll be doing all those things. Okay?
Yeah.
Fine, sir. Thank you. I think, if we don't have any doubts, we can close the session. Or if we'll first stop the recording.
Yes,